and they will, through their mystic rituals, determine who he is. He's now claiming that, you know, next time he might actually reincarnate into someone in the West instead of the typical Tibetan societies where he originally came from. You know, there's that mysticism that I object to. That's a large reason of why I can respect Buddhism, but I can never follow it myself.
Well put. And do you know if that most Buddhists actually take that, I would call, extreme approach? Or is that just a subsect, kind of like the fundamentalists in the U.S.?
It's the official dogma, but like every religious person on the planet, how much people buy into it is a matter of individual preference. Everybody cherry-picks their religion. Everybody cherry-picks their morals and beliefs.
Yeah, I mean, as far as practical Buddhism, it's probably the one I know the least about as far as the major religions are concerned. I mean, because I personally know Hindus, Muslims, and Christians, and Jews. I even know a few Sikhs, if you know what Sikh is. I mean, I don't know any Buddhists, so I don't have any idea about, like, practical Buddhism.
Most of the Buddhists that I know aren't too worried about the mystic elements. They're more attracted to the meditative and the way of life as opposed to the spiritual aspect.
Which I agree with. I find meditation, like, it's something that has a non-religious, a completely anti-theist, new word I want today, or this week, I understand now. There's still a spiritual aspect to life, and it's just inside your brain. And you, nothing wrong with trying to look inside, right, and reach, look for your questions so you can find the truth after, right?
Well, it has the benefit of having quantifiable medical benefits. I mean, they have actually studied the impact of meditation on people's brains and discovered that people who meditate on a regular basis have more complex brain structures than people who don't. I mean, sure. they can measure the growth in your brain when you meditate.
That's some crazy shit. I did not know that.
That is deeply cool shit.
Huh.
Meditate. So they've pegged onto something that has direct benefit to us and incorporated it into their religion. Doesn't mean that they originated it. Doesn't mean that there's a supernatural quality to it. It means that they've taken something that really does work and they've assigned it as a value in their religion.
Kind of like potentially the bleeding of the animal, right? There might be, or there at the time, yeah. It looked like it had a benefit, so it became law.
Yes. That's what I find in the history of every religion. It's not so much that they originate concepts, it's that they take concepts that seem to work and they incorporate it into dogma. They make it part of a ritual so that they encourage people to continue doing it. But at the same time, they also encourage people not to question it. Don't look too closely at it. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain.
I have a little kind of outside point. I was looking at the Skype chat, and whenever you're talking, Gandalf lights up because that's your avatar.
Yep.
Which I think is really awesome. I love Lord of the Rings and read it multiple times. Best books ever. Why did you put Gandalf there? He seems like, no, he's a very religious figure in fantasy world, but why do we, you obviously like Gandalf if you use him as your avatar, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, why do you respect that kind of person or character?
Tolkien was a Christian apologist. He was a contemporary of the fellow who wrote the Chronicles of Narnia, whose name I know but escapes me at this moment. But even though he was attempting to relay a religious message, although a very mild one in his attempt at world building, really what he was doing was he was telling a story, and he was taking his experiences in World War II and creating a world out of those experiences. That's a lot of what, according to his later writings about the Lord of the Rings, what that was all about. So he was creating a fictional character and establishing a cliche. I mean, one of the originators of the cliche that really struck people's imagination. The reason I chose that avatar was less because Gandalf was in it, but more because the quote was in it, which reads... now I have to
be wary of wizards, for they are subtle and quick to lay down suppressing fire.
That's the one.
I mean, like,
go ahead.
Just because something is religious in nature doesn't mean it's inherently bad. Like, I listen to metal music, and the band As I Lay Dying, they're a Christian band, but I still enjoy their music. So, I mean, just because, like, it is inherently religious, and you don't have to agree with everything they say to enjoy their works.
Yeah, precisely. It's the same reason that we atheists celebrate Christmas. While we don't share the religious aspect of it, we go there to enjoy family and food. And the difference is that while it means something in the context of the brains of the believer, it means something else to us.
I don't have to be religious in order to appreciate the Sistine Chapel.
Yeah.
And
you go to the Duomo in Florence, and it's like, it's a freaking amazing building. And it's done a lot, right? Like, we might not be where we are today without religion backing us. And I don't... It's impossible to reimagine 2011 without religion. Maybe we'd still be in the Stone Age, right? But we have to continually look for the truth, and I find that a lot of religious people have settled for it, and it's just normal for humans to settle into comfort. So if we've settled with it and we're happy, it's like, why carry on with the search?
Like, I mean, I believe that religion was an evolutionary adaptation. I just believe that we've gone beyond it, or beyond the need for it, yet we're still clinging to it instead of moving forward. And that's a problem.
What I've heard in terms of where it comes from is that we are pattern-seeking creatures. A lot of the higher life forms on our planet are. By that, I mean that we'll see outlines in the bush that might look like something, even though it isn't. It's how we can look at the sky and see bunny rabbits.
Yes.
Yeah, that's called pareidolia, by the way.
Ah, thank you. Oh. It has a benefit in that if we're out in the wilderness and we're wanting to stay alive, is that shadow that we see really a cougar, some kind of predatory animal that we want to avoid, or is it just something that looks like it? Erring on the side of caution, you know, even if we've only got a 50-50 chance, we've expanded the possibility that we're going to survive this encounter. So... It's an advantageous adaptation, but it's one that can trick us, because the shadow isn't always a predatory animal.
Mm-hmm. I mean, like, how I was thinking about it is that, with the development of our brains the way they are, we developed curiosity. And, but I'm guessing at the time when we first started to get, like, curious about wondering why things happened or how things happened, that energy we would spend searching for those answers would be better used surviving. So it would, like, a quick way to get an answer, so you could focus more on getting your food, getting your housing, running from predators, or whatever you needed to do. And but now that we're settled, we have plenty of food, plenty of resources, we're safe, we're developed and stable, now we have time to ponder those questions, and now we're trying to move beyond religion.
Well, interesting fact about that. I don't know if you guys know the Ionians a bit. Carl Sagan talks a lot about them in Cosmos. Like, 2,000 years ago, there was this sort of scientific atheist uprising. It was just crushed by religion, mm-hmm. though.
Greeks. There was a Greek philosophical movement, the origination of epistemology, the knowledge of how we know things. And they basically made, originated by Epicurus, wasn't it? Epicurus?
Mm-hmm.
And he basically said, accept what you see, but believe nothing until you verify it. Take everything at face value, work with it as though, you know, you've got a working hypothesis, but don't assume anything until you've got a way to figure out whether or not it's true or not. Only believe what is true. And there was, in fact, something about an uprising. It was nonviolent, as far as I understand. But it was a struggle between that and the religious movements at the time. And, of course, the religious movements wiped them out. The only reason we even know about them is because their writings were preserved.
To get back a bit to the topic, the first thing I wanted us to discuss more in depth is, why is religious extremism today dangerous? We've talked about it before, during the conversation as we've been going, but really, do you guys have any good examples of how religion impacts us? And Manuel was writing something in the chat. I mean, gays can't reproduce, so that's why God says it's wrong. We shouldn't kill gays, per se. Like, why would anyone have something against homosexuals? Like, that's religion impacts other people. What people do in their private life has zero impact, right?
I mean, as far as why they have something against it, it's similar to the situation with Socrates is corrupting the minds of the youth. If we say this is okay for these people, it our youth may take it to mean that it's okay for them and thus lead them off into a sinful lifestyle. That's the mindset behind all the hate, as far as I can understand.
And your religious belief is not necessarily private either, as your beliefs inform your actions.
Mm-hmm. I actually wrote about this last year. There's a fellow named Steven Pinker who wrote a really lengthy article, and I do mean really lengthy article, in which he summarized our understanding of human morality to date. He referenced Jonathan Haidt in his Moral Foundations of Theory, but kind of refuted a bunch of what Haidt was writing. Pinker was saying that there are five. All of our morality boils down to five basic pillars: harm, fairness or justice, in-group or loyalty, authority, and purity. We place different weight on these five pillars, such as for myself, the primary focus is on caring for others, making sure that I don't come to harm, that they don't come to harm. And the other focus is on fairness or justice, making sure that everybody's treated equally. I don't have as much focus on loyalty or authority or purity. And the prohibitions against homosexuality in particular are about purity. People have been indoctrinated to believe that homosexuality is an act of impurity, that they're violating themselves and anyone else they come in contact with because of their sexual deviancy. And as I had written to Emmanuel earlier, there was in fact a viable reason for this back in the days when the first Ten Commandments were first written down, even though the idea predates them. Humanity had no more than 100,000 or 300,000 people on the entire planet. Infant mortality was exceedingly high. You were likely to lose 8 out of 10 children that you had. So there was a quantifiable need for everyone of breeding, capable of breeding, of reproducing, to reproduce.
But the thing is, you can always have guys reproducing, as long as you have enough women, right? Like, one guy can spread to a very large amount of women. Mm-hmm. So, I'm not sure if I agree with that's actually how that hate came along, because it seems kind of...
It's a justification for the argument. Obviously, men who are homosexual are still capable of reproducing with women. But if their focus isn't on reproducing with women, then they're not as likely to do the job quite as enthusiastically, as thoroughly as needed. It was essentially seen as, it's different, therefore it is impure, therefore it must be shunned. That's the way the argument goes, anyway.
Hmm. Yeah. They also like to label it as unnatural, which is actually contrary to what we see in nature. We have... We actually know that homosexuality exists in most animals.
Well, it's just a genetic thing, right? Like, it's normal. It happens to some people.
They like to argue that it's not normal and doesn't give any evolutionary